here. We have, oh, thank you. I would like to welcome everybody who has joined us tonight for the San Joaquin County California Rare Fruit Grower Meeting. Tonight, we have a very special presentation, and we will be listening and hearing from Marta Matvienko. And I just want to tell you a little bit about her. Marta Matvienko is a professional plant geneticist. She worked for companies involved with genomics technologies, next generation sequencing, and bioinformatics. Currently, she manages the Fringe Coffee R&D site in Davis. She started gardening back in her teens in Central Asia in the Republic of Uzbekistan, which was a part of the Soviet Union at the time. Later, she tended her plants and gardens in St. Petersburg, Russia, Wageningen, the Netherlands, and New Brunswick, New Jersey. After settling down in Davis, she started her current home plantings in 2001. Since joining the California Rare Fruit Growers in 2011, her fruit tree collection grew from a few dozen to hundreds of trees. She enjoys growing stone fruits, pomegranates, persimmons, citrus, white sapotes, and experiments with many other subtropical fruits. And she documents all her findings at her blog spot, fruitsandgardening.blogspot.com. And she is a member of the CRFG Board of Directors, where she leads the Fruit Variety Registration Program. So we are so excited to have her here tonight. Marta, if you're ready, I will let you go ahead and take over.
Perfect. Yeah, thank you so much, Jenny, for the introduction. So let me share my my desktop. And let me go to the presentation mode. Yep. Are we good?
I think we're good, right? Great.
Okay, perfect. Yeah. So yeah, so Jenny already told you everything about me. So let me just show you a few sites of my employer, because at some point you guys asked about coffee and who could present about coffee. Today I was reminded that I actually recommended your speaker. So Ramiro Lobo is talking to you about coffee and your in future very soon for you. So I currently work for Fringe Coffee. And if you never heard of this company, this is website, and if I click, what you see here is my company website, and shopping can be done right from here. So what we do, we produce super special coffee. Look at these products as expensive wines, basically. So if you're into coffee, you're welcome to come and check our offerings here. Besides coffee, we also grow various exotic fruits, and the company has its own farm where we grow a variety of exotic tropical, subtropical fruits. So that's what we grow. But currently, I just checked what we actually have because it's all seasonal. So right now, the only products you can buy from us are avocados and finger limes. We call them caviar limes, but it's the same thing as a finger lime. And recently, we also started offering tours. So the next tour is on August 13th. So the people can go taste coffee and go through the farm and see how coffee and other tropical fruits grow. So that was just, yeah, so Jenny introduced me. You already know all this part, and this is part about my company. So let's go to my actual presentation. And I grow a variety of fruits. I was able to minimize some other window I had here. So I grow a variety of fruits. It is always very difficult to select what exactly I'm going to talk about. But at some point I decided that when I'm doing such overview talks, I'm just going to pick a few very unusual fruits, especially maybe those ones which I I particularly like or introduced or think that they should be more popular than they are now and split them by seasons. And that's what I'm doing today. Let me see where I'm on the table. Yeah. So for spring, see, I decided I will bring my talk to spring, summer, fall, winter. And while I grow a lot of typical, you know, a lot of roots will grow like citrus, guavas, stone fruit, berries. I'm going to talk for spring only about four things here. Avocado, which I selected myself, various mulberries, which I think they should be much more popular than they are now. Suriname cherry, which I introduced myself, and about loquats, some of the selections which I'm trying to popularize more. So let's start from avocado. Actually, about this avocado, you can read in the issue of Fruit Gardener, this January, February issue. So I actually did a small article on this particular cultivar, which I also registered. So let's start from the fruits and how fruits look like in this variety. So first of all, it's a spring fruits. And this is actually very important for us here in the Central Valley because most of our cold hardy avocados, they fruit in fall, like November, December. So this is a spring one. So it has some Guatemalan genetics in it. It's a big fruit. It's a very large fruit. Very easily, can be peeled very easily. The skin is soft, but you probably don't want to eat this skin. So this is not like Mexicola skin, which you can easily eat. So this skin you would like to peel typically. The flesh is very smooth. And while the seed is large, relatively large, there is plenty of flesh to it. So, and what I also learned about avocados just recently is that the length of the neck, and you see here that my fruits, they have very long necks, actually weather dependent. Because if we go to the next slide and you can see the original fruits I collected in Santa Rosa in March of 2016, they mature, but more importantly, they're in much more protected location over there. They're in between two buildings. My trees, which are producing now these long fruits, they're much more exposed to elements in the farmland of Vacaville. So the tree was in private yard. My husband and I, we basically invited ourselves. We asked the owners of the house to show us the tree because we knew that the tree was in that location. And they invited us, we collected some immature fruits, they let us to collect them science, and I started making those trees right away. I already had rootstocks, those were Duke seedlings rootstocks, which I started to grow in fall of 2015. So that's how the first trees were made. And then I started planting them around the building in Vacaville. So my friends have a farm in Vacaville, and they let me use basically as experimental playground for some of my plantings. So you can see that this is one tree and the second tree. So I planted two trees at the same time in 2018, and what I found at that time, that a couple of years later actually, is that eastern walls actually better for protection than southern walls. So this is a tree by southern wall, this is a tree by eastern wall. Why? I suspect because the sun hits first eastern wall if we have some frosts in winter, if on cold winter nights. So the trees by eastern walls they recover faster. The same thing I noticed on Duke trees. Actually, I had Dukes planted at the same time on Duke seedlings, and the behavior of Duke trees was the same. Okay. So then fast forward. So this was tree in 2018. This tree is by the southern wall, which was the smallest tree. And 2 years later, it is above the building. So this particular cultivar is a very fast growing. It has a pyramidal shape and also very precocious. So the tree started fruiting, basically, I think it bloomed in the third year after grafting and produced the first fruits, I think were produced last year. No, I wrote a publication already last year. So maybe it's bloomed in the second year and produced the fruits in the third year. Because, let me see, yeah, I don't have it here, but it is in publication. So, basically, the ripening, the fruit ripening time is almost a year. The fruit, the blooming time is April, and the fruiting time is March, April. So it has to be on the tree about 11 months. The fruit has to develop for about 11 months. Okay. Somehow I feel that I missed one slide to show you. So I will quickly go back and see if I still have. Yeah, this is a slide I forgot to show you. So it's actually important thing to keep in mind that I garden in two locations. I garden in Davis, where my home and backyard is, and it's a very protected location. So in Davis, I can grow much more of the cold sensitive plants than I can grow in Vacaville. So Vacaville is a farmland basically. And in Vacaville, the air masses move much, much faster. And the differences between lows and highs are more wide than in Davis. So if in Davis we can have, let's say at night, maybe 28-30 is a minimum at night and winter, in Vacaville it actually easily can go to 23 Fahrenheit, for example. And the same for the high summer temperatures. It's always few degrees hotter in Vacaville. So while I try to grow basically, a lot of fruits I grow, they overlap between Davis and Vacaville locations. Actually, not everything I can grow in Vacaville, what I can grow in Davis. Some are more like I would not be able to grow in Davis dragon fruits or white sapotas. I would not be able to do it in Davis or in Vacaville, or I would not be able to grow there more sensitive things like black sapota. But there is one cherry moy actually, which I already grow in Vacaville, but that was a selection out of 200 different seedlings. Okay, let's move on. So I covered my locations, I covered avocado, royal rye, and so basically I'm actively distributing wood from this cultivar, and I always have wood at the summer exchange, at the spring exchange in for Sacramento chapter. I probably will bring wood. It's not the best time to graft now, but I might bring some wood from it to the Greenwood Exchange. We are going to have Redwood Empire chapter is going to have in Sebastopol. So I probably will bring it some wood by end of this month. They have some meeting over there. Yeah, but if you guys ever interested to get wood, just, you know, coordinate with me, come here, or we will find a way to pass wood from this cultivar onto your chapter. Okay, let's go into mulberries. Mulberry somehow is very unknown fruit in the United States. Not many people grow them as a fruit tree. So only fruitless mulberries are popular here as a landscaping tree. But I think it's they are getting a little bit more established. And I think it started from Pakistan cultivar, and everyone knows Pakistan. But I grow a number of different cultivars. And one thing to keep in mind that Morus alba and Morus macrura, they are spring fruits, and they will be fruiting somewhere between April and June, while Morus nigra, which is sometimes called Persian mulberry, they will be fruiting between June and July, maybe into August. Yeah, it's August now. Yeah, I still see some fruits. So June to August will be for Morus nigra.
Okay.
So I decided to describe just a few cultivars, which I think are important to have around, important to spread around. First of all, is Four Seasons Mulberry. Sometimes it's also called Taiwanese Four Seasons. This particular cultivar can be fruiting year round. Basically, as soon as we have our growing temperatures, the temperatures like above 60 degrees, it starts leafing out and it starts making fruits right away. And I had fruits from this tree as late as December. Okay, the fruits are relatively large, plump, very juicy. But the problem I think with these fruits, I see, well, we don't have this problem here in Central Valley, and you probably also don't have it because you have really high summer temperatures. But like for a mild Bay Area situations, they may not sweeten up well, because my first harvest in April, May is never as sweet as my fruit starting from July and on. So this is something to keep in mind, that this is probably not for mild locations, but for really hot locations. And this is a small tree. So this tree, basically, I think it probably will not ever grow above 10 feet. So this is a small tree with a thin branches. It doesn't make, you know, the fat branches, which we usually associate with fast growing, vigorous mulberries. Pakistan, everyone knows Pakistan, excellent fruits. You can get this cultivar very often, sometimes even in many nurseries, but sometimes even in Home Depot. But it's a very large tree and it requires pruning. But if you never had any mulberries, at least start from Pakistan, which is relatively easily available. This white, long white mulberries. So I highly recommend them too, because especially to people who don't like any acid in their fruits. So these are purely sweet mulberries. And I got three cultivars, so named three different cultivars, but to me they're all the same. I don't see any difference. They're all grafted in my case on the same tree, and they all look the same. So it's a Saharanpur local. That's a name which is available in the USDA green database. And it's probably the most proper name to use, but since in the nursery trade, they already go under different names, and sometimes they're also called Himalayan white. Another stick I got was called as a Pakistan white, and another stick I got was Australian green. So all the same, all good fruit, excellent fruits, very sweet, like honey sweet fruits, and fast growing, will need pruning all the time. And so highly recommend it if you can get around. But the sticks I always had at the exchanges. The problem with these accessions, they don't root. So don't waste the wood you get for this accession trying to root it. It's very, very low percentage, maybe under 1% of rooting chance. So try to graft it. Grow mulberry seedlings and graft this cultivar. Like Pakistan, you can easily root. Four Seasons, you can easily root, but not this one. Buloklom. A buloklo is another fast-growing white mulberry without any acid. So it's more juicy than white Pakistan or Saharanpur local, which was on the previous slide. You can see that these mulberries, they are shorter, but they're kind of much fatter, and they're also late. So they're later, they're coming up after the Pakistan white, a little bit after. So they're more like a June fruit. And very sweet, honey sweet, so a fast growing tree. Also we'll need a lot of pruning, but very, very nice fruits. And I think people used to these fruits a lot. Where I grew up in Central Asia, so we had a lot of these white mulberries. I know that people in Turkey also consume a lot of these fruits, and they also used, they used for drying. As a dry fruit. Dimur 9 of Himalayan mulberries. It looks like there are a number of Himalayan mulberries now showing up around, and I'm trying to figure out which are the same, which are not, but this one I have experienced growing for a number of years already. It's clearly not a Pakistan. It's a completely different mulberry. The leaves are different, the fruits are different. So the fruits are very long and they're thinner than Pakistan. And they're also earlier than Pakistan. They start fruiting before Pakistan. The flavor is very complex. I would say maybe more complex than Pakistan and more sweet than Pakistan. So when I give people to try different mulberries, they usually prefer Himalayan to Pakistan. But the same problem with this mulberry as with white long mulberries, it does not root. This one needs to be grafted. So don't waste your wood if you ever get it. By rooting it, just graft it. Graft it on whatever you have, on seedlings or on any other established trees. And the grafting is very easy for mulberries. It can be done even now using green wood. Also fast growing trees also will need pruning. And there are, looks like there are a few other accessions I'm starting to evaluate now, which have similar fruits. But I know that another one I have is different than this one. But there is a sort one just came to my attention, which I wasn't sure, which I'm still not sure if it's the same or different. So yeah. And Black Prince. So Black Prince was my recent discovery, and I found a tree somewhere north of Sacramento, which was grafted a long time ago, but now was redistributed, and I don't know why, because actually this one easily roots, as I learned. So in beginning, when I just got this accession, of course I grafted because I didn't want to lose any wood, and year later I found that I can easily root these mulberries using dormant wood, and winter they also root with green wood, also easily rooting. And this is an excellent mulberry. It's very late, it's very unusual, it has very large fat fruits, which are complex, which are very sweet, have a little bit of acidity. They're actually not leaking. I think this particular mulberry can be relatively easily shipped and sold. And this one definitely should get into commercial cultivation and production. And the unusual thing that when you break a fruit, you will see that it's white inside, which is not usual. The other unusual thing about this mulberry, and I'm trialing some others, actually Buluclaw too, they leaf out very late. So what it means that this mulberry is waiting until weather is really stable. It's not a problem for us. We are relatively warm here, but for people who are living in a more cold situation, you really want this type of mulberries, which will take frost and they will not leaf out early. So then the early frosts can kill the new buds or new fruits. Okay. So this was developed in Ukraine quite a while ago. It's actually available on Russian and Ukrainian websites, but someone a long time ago planted this on a tree somewhere in north of Sacramento. So I was actually very surprised to find this mulberry. So this is a summary for mulberries. So they really deserve a better distribution. And it would be nice to get more of them into the box stores. Every time I'm giving a presentation, I'm hoping, okay, maybe there are some nursery, large scale nursery people listening. Yeah, if you are, guys, you need to get this material and start placing these really nice cultivars into the box stores. Because I think the only way for these cultivars to survive long term is to start to be distributed through really large chains. Okay, let's go on to lockwats. Actually, I can stop here, and if there are any questions on mulberries or avocado, maybe I should answer. Are we good, Jenny?
I do not see any questions good. In the chat. Okay. If anybody would like to ask a question, go ahead and put it in the chat. And then next time she takes a break, we will look at that chat and find those questions. Thank you.
Okay, let's go on to loquats. Some time ago, I also got very interested in loquats. I don't know how it happened, but I got my first loquats probably from Patrick Schaffer or from Mark Albert, and started tasting them and started propagating them and comparing them. So now I have quite a collection of loquats. Actually, I have more than what listed here. And started tasting them. So here's one of the tasting spreads I have here. Some are just seedlings like this Hasip and Frana. A friend from Sacramento brought them to me. So one he named for him Hasip, and another he named Frana for his wife. So these two loquats, for example, they completely don't have any acid. So those people really like the loquats sweet without any acids. So, and that's a very interesting thing about loquat, because they can taste very different. You can have absolutely sweet fruits, or you can have very acidic fruits, or you can have a mix of both, and you can also have a lot of different flavors in it. For example, Frana fruit has a flavor of green peas in it, and it was very unusual to taste this flavor in Frana. Kando, for example, has like an apple sauce taste. Its delight is clearly like a pear taste. Fletcher White is like a pear and grape for me. I really don't like Brandenton. I don't want to talk even about it. But Argelino, right now, I think Argelino is probably one of the most complex in terms of flavor and really how intense that flavor in this fruit is. So Argelino has a good amount of sweetness and sourness, and it has a lot of flavors, including maybe sometimes I even can taste mango in Argelino. The only thing about Argelino to keep in mind, it's a relatively late fruit. So like if I would like from this spread, if I would just like to have couple, let's say, I would probably go for Ed's Delight, which is very early and sweet and has a little bit of acidity, and Argelino, which is much later. But there are many more tastings you can find on my blog and see what is there. So it's just, it's a very small sample from the fruits I grow. And there are many other cultivars, which are spring ones and orange ones like Mogi, and the Spana and Jazzy, those are earlier than Argelino. And they're also very sweet and nice and large fruits. Yeah, so here I'm talking more about Argelino. Argelino are really large fruits. It's orange flesh fruits, and that's how it compares with some other cultivars here. So Fletcher White is a very, very nice fruit. It's very complex. I would say that Fletcher White is more complex than Ed's Delight, but Fletcher White is a smaller fruits, and they're a little bit later for me than Ed's Delight. But there are clearly some similarities, and they both are white fruits. And Fletcher White is also incredibly productive. Lots, big bunches of small fruits. And I never get chance, I never get just around to trying to thin them and see if it will help with the size. Kando, I liked Kando early on because it was a sweet. So Kando, you kind of can taste early because it doesn't have a lot of acidity, but after I tried many other cultivars, I'm not so fond of Kando because it's not as complex as many others, but it's a very nice large sweet fruit, and it's a little bit earlier than Argelino. Yeah, so some people prefer Kando to Argelino because it's less acidity, but some people actually don't taste sweetness in Kando. So it's really, you have to taste. You have to taste the fruits before you figure out. So don't just rely on my opinion about the fruits, just my taste buds. Okay, so the things which I kind of already stopped growing or removed. I removed Albert's Early Italian from my collection. I removed Brandenton from my collection. I think I still have a branch of Gold Nugget, but I'm not a fan of this cultivar. Macbeth, I thought I removed it, but actually one branch stayed on, and this year Macbeth actually was pretty good. So it also probably depends how flavor develops. No, I know that it really depends on the weather patterns, also from different fruits. So Macbeth might be okay. So at least some year. So this year Macbeth was good. Napa Library I just removed simply because it's very, very small fruits. Okay. So I'm listing here some best performers here, but now I also would list here probably Mogi, Espana, Jazzy, and some others. So so there are lots of good loquats. So the most updated information you always will find on my blog about loquats, because I try to do posts as I taste fruits. It's not doesn't always work, but I'm trying. Okay. Any questions? If no questions, I will move to Suriname cherry.
No questions in
okay.
the chat.
Okay, good. So Suriname cherry. So this particular cultivar actually my introduction. And you also will find a small article in Fruit Gardener from January issue from me on how what it is about and how this variety performs in my climate, where it's coming from. And the interesting thing about this cultivar, well, it's now a cultivar, but it's actually seedling, but I started propagating and distributing it. The mother of this plant had yellow and smooth fruits. The fruit I tasted a while ago didn't have any ribs and was kind of yellow-orange in color. So when 3 years after I finally got fruits from the progeny, from that yellow ribless fruit, I was really surprised that I got this very dark, almost black fruit, a little bit ribbed. So that was really surprising. But at least the fruit tasted really good. So the fruit flavor is very intense, and the ripe fruits don't have this resinous flavor, which we don't like usually in Suriname cherry. It has very clear kind of orangey notes in it. The tree also turned out to be a very fast and very vigorous grower, and it tolerates frosts pretty well in Davis. We have been down while this tree was growing, we've been down to 23, 24, and this tree made it. Right now, this tree is very tall, at least 12 feet, I would say. And I actually had to prune it. It's very, it was very surprising to me, actually, that I had to prune Pitanga in Davis, which is not the optimal climate for it. Another distinctive characteristic of this tree is it makes fruits in all sizes. The very early fruits, which usually made like in May, they are seedless and they're small. As the season progresses, the fruits become larger and they become seeded. And I believe in one of the fruits this year, I found actually 3 seeds. So what I suspect about this cultivar is that it's a hybrid. It was that yellow fruit was pollinated by who knows what. Another pitanga, which was very different probably, and I got this hybrid. And now I'm distributing seedlings and trying to bring them to the production and see what will happen. Yeah, I have this picture. So this was a mother. This was a mother of my Guarujá red. So that's how the fruits were looking on the mother. And now I distributed lots of seeds and lots of seedlings. And I planted them at our fringe coffee farm. And actually, a couple of months ago when I was there, some started fruiting. But the first 2 trees which fruited, they also been making the fruits which were very similar to Guarujá red. So they also been very dark red and very nicely flavored. What I'm looking for in all these seedlings, I want to get my orange back. So I really hope that some will segregate and I will get light colored fruits out of some of the progenies. And it's also kind of a public and distributed phenotyping projects, because I'm not able to grow hundreds of seedlings, but hopefully coordinating this with many other people, we will be able to find something useful for the future and select something we really will enjoy too, in different colors and different shape of the fruit, and maybe different flavors too. Okay, those were four spring fruits I decided to talk about, okay? If there are no questions on spring fruits, let's move on.
There is one question. Mm-hmm. There is a mulberry question in the chat. Mm-hmm. What do you think of world's best mulberry, and is it similar to Thai dwarf?
Okay, I don't have Thai dwarf. I don't know what is Thai dwarf. I have I have world's best. In the growth habit, world's best is very similar to four seasons mulberry, but it's more vigorous actually. It's more vigorous than four seasons. In terms of berry flavor, I think it is simpler than four seasons. So it's not as intense as four seasons. That's only reference point I can use. And sorry, because I don't have Thai dwarf. I don't have that one. But while I'm not a big fan of a world's best, I think the berries are very the berries basically can be stored pretty well, so they are not leaking, they are much more dense, and those ones probably also can be used in commercial production. The only thing I'm afraid of when we will introduce kind of this sub-optimal in terms of flavor fruits to larger cultivation, we can a little bit spoil the opinion of public about the entire group of fruits, because if world's best is already doesn't have optimal flavor, if growers will start picking it even earlier so they can move the fruit longer distances and supermarketers can keep them longer on the shelf, so the fruit might not taste very well. But homegrown world's best is okay fruit. But right now I'm basically using it as a rootstock in my situation, because I have many cultivars which are much better than world's best. But it has its place. It has its place, and I know that people like it and do jams out of it. So that's my opinion. No questions?
That's it. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Let's move on to summer fruits. So for summer fruits, I will be talking, you see, I grow tons of different things. Again, for summer, we will have a lot of fruits. Like right now, what I have around my dinner table and in my fridge, in my kitchen, on my floors, I have a lot of melons, and they even not on this picture, because I also grow various Central Asian Persian melons. So there are some fruits we grow in huge amounts, stone fruits, apples, summer apple, grapes, dragon fruits are ripening now too, apricots, we are past of the apricot season by now. But the three particular fruits I'm going to talk are just sour cherry, simply because we don't grow it, and I do. I grow dwarf grumichama, which is probably, maybe, I don't know, maybe just less than a handful of people grow here. And also oak leaf papaya, which I think also deserves a better distribution. So let's move on to sour cherries. So a few years back, I decided that I want a good sour cherry. And since they were not really available around, and I didn't know what is going to produce, how they're going to taste here, I decided that I just order or find as many as I can. And that's what I did. I obtained 12 cultivars from Geneva site of USDA site in Geneva, New York. 12 cultivars from there and many others from some friends in Santa Clara Valley chapter and Redwood Empire chapter, and started, grafted them on two different rootstocks and started growing them and evaluating. But these guys, they are not precocious. Most of them are not precocious. So I have only very limited information now, but what I have now is basically the front runner I have now is Sumadinka. And that's what you see on this picture and this picture. It's a very typical sour cherry, and it comes in a very large size and produces well in Central Valley, and it can be grafted onto sweet cherry. So it basically grafts on all rootstocks I tried, the typical cherry rootstocks, Mazart, Mahalep, Adara, or sweet cherry. You can graft it on any of those and it will grow. It is vigorous grower and it is precocious. So it fruited for me like in second year. Duke, I grew Duke fruits, but it didn't produce for me many fruits yet. Almas produced a little bit. But I also don't have any opinion about if Almas is going to make a lot of fruit in future. Okay. One thing to remember that I'm mostly evaluating them in Vacaville, and in winter in Vacaville, and most of winters we have close to 1,000 chill hours. So I don't know how they will perform in milder situations, but at least they take this very hot, incredibly hot summer. So Sumadinka is now the best from what I have, from what I evaluated. But the things might change when other cultivars will start fruiting in a year or two. Dwarf Grumichama. It's very different. So it's coming from Brazil. It's also kind of a cherry-sized fruit. And sometimes they called even the same name. So it's a Brazilian, dwarf Brazilian cherry. They sometimes also can be called. And it's a small tree, it's a my seedling which I started growing maybe 3 or 4 years ago, precocious, very nicely fruiting in the pot, and the flavor is pretty complex, and it takes relatively low temperatures, which we had in last year. Well, low, we didn't have real lows in last 3-4 years, but we probably went down to 28-29, something like that, and the pot is by southern wall, but I think it can go into ground and will produce on ground. And very productive, so it blooms abundantly and produces abundantly, but it needs water. It really needs to be irrigated very well during flowering and fruit development, otherwise it will drop the fruits. And you can see the scat fruits, they have this very nice orange colored flesh. And usually it's 1 or 2 seeds inside and fruit is absolutely black. And this tree will not be large, it's a small tree. So this I even have not started propagating yet, but I will try to start doing air layers and maybe make more seedlings of this. Okay. So I also want to introduce this one into coffee orchards. It's kind of, I think it will be nice looking inside of coffee plantations. In terms of flavor, it's a complex. So my son and husband, they saw that it's blueberry-like. I don't sense like it's blueberry-like. I even cannot describe this flavor, but it's a very pleasant berry-like flavor. I think that's what I can say now from what I remember. Oakleaf papaya. So oakleaf papayas, I started growing maybe 2017. Yeah, it means that I got them like in fall of 2016. I got very tiny seedlings. These particular trees, I guess we can call them trees. They are dioecious, so they can be males or females. Out of these 4 seedlings, only one turned out to be female, and three others are males here. But Yorkshire can graft a female branch onto a male, and it will be producing just fine. So the funny thing about this one is that it will fruit in the first year. So already by end of 2017, in the first year in the ground, female made few fruits. And now I have tons of fruits. Like the trees became like a really huge stands of papaya over there. And right now, yeah, I already seen fruits there, and I tasted some. So around August, they will be producing. This is berry. Basically, it's a papaya berry. And the flavor here, to me, they taste like a condensed sweet milk. And if you don't bite into the seeds, and if you bite into the seeds, you will get a little bit of a spicy flavor. So I think it's a very nice use of this fruit would be in salads. You just add them into salads, which are sour and sweet salads, and they can be used that way, or just used eating from hand too. So the size is pretty small. So this is the size of like a Thompson sweet, how we call this grape. Yeah, so the small seedless grape, and this is them. In terms of temperatures, they easily take down to 23. So that's what happens in Vacaville, in this location. And they deleave completely in winter, but in spring, they just start sprouting like nothing happened, and they are continuing growing. So it's very hardy. And they become really nice kind of a sculptural trees. So I think they would be actually very nice landscaping trees also in cities around Central Valley. So that was my quick overview of summer fruits, and now I'm moving into the fall.
There is one question from Stacy. She says, have you seen a hermaphrodite oak leaf papaya? I have a male and female, but there is a fruit on my male this year.
Wow, nice. No, I didn't see it. I didn't see it. Yeah. The trees are pretty flexible, and sometimes males will produce some female flowers. Interesting. No, I didn't see hermaphrodite. Yeah, but cool. It's cool. Just watch that tree. What I would say, watch that tree and see if it's stable and maybe propagated, because then you would need just one tree because they graft. Yeah, it's very nice. Okay, let's move on to fall. And for the fall, I selected, so as you can see, for the fall, also tons of fruit. In fall, I grow tons of pomegranates, different cultivars, but it would be a big another presentation if I would start talking about pomegranates or feijoas or dragon fruits or avocados. So this is all I grow. And of course, figs. Yeah, figs just started to fruit. It's very nice. Yeah, fig season just came. And actually, very early citrus also will starts for me around September, October, early satsumas are starting. So, but here I'm talking about American persimmons, Chirimoya, Kayapals, and Sinjet, because I suspect many of you don't grow them or maybe you never heard of some of these fruits. So, American persimmons. So, I don't know how I got, I know how I got introduced again by Patrick Schaffer and Mark Albert. So they grow them in Mendocino and Sonoma counties. And my first tree I bought from Patrick quite a while ago. But what I quickly learned is that the tree which fruits for him in Mendocino really doesn't like my heat in the Central Valley. So it's dropping fruits, it's blooming profusely, but it's dropping fruits all the time after the first waves of over 100 degrees we are getting here. So then I started acquiring other accessions. And some accessions are much more tolerant to our heat and they produce really nice fruits. And this is accessions I'm listing here. First of all, this lemon delight, which is 146, I believe. It has also another number, which is 146. Early jewel probably also has another number, which I don't remember. And Midder is very old cultivars. This is actually a second largest Native American fruit after papaws. But somehow on this coast, we don't really grow many of them because we have kaki, we have Asian persimmons, and many people prefer actually just non-astringent fuyu, and that's good enough, and that's what was mass propagated here. But the flavors of these persimmons are much more complex. They're much more complex than hachia. They really have this very strong butterscotch rum flavor in them. Of course, they're astringent. They need to be fully ripened and they need to be completely soaked. And preferably, they also need to fall from the tree before you eat them. But wonderful fruits, if you never grew them, I would recommend start growing them, and these accessions available from online nurseries, and they can be obtained and during winter and they grow in our climate. So one note I would like to say here, I actually discovered a nice growth of these persimmons in Coloma. Coloma is a city of gold miners, which was basically a center of Californian civilization around in the middle of 19th century, when a lot of people from East moved to the area, and also a lot of Chinese workers moved to work on gold mines and built later on a railroad. But this particular American persimmons most likely were introduced by the farming family of Monroe, which were farming in that area. They eventually had over 300 acres there, and they were providing a lot of fruit. Right now, it's basically a small touristic town with a nice historic park, but some very old trees are still there. And there are groves of these American persimmons along with Asian persimmons, which I think Chinese brought there. So, sometime when you have time, go explore old towns, and there are really nice surprises. Actually, I wrote an article about it, but that was a year ago. That was probably a year and a half ago, also on Fruit Gardener. So if anyone is interested, I can type later, give you a reference for that particular piece. Okay. And now moving on to another fall fruit, which is about the same time. So these guys, you will have them fruiting between October and December, and sometimes into January. Yeah, I would say between October and January, you will get these fruits. Chia, in my climate, I'm getting around November. So what is chia? It is Maclura tricuspidatae. So it's also dioecious tree. You need to have a male and female. Actually, don't have to have a male. Females will fruit, but the fruits will be smaller and fruits will be seedless and fruits will be less flavorful without pollination, but it's possible to grow them without male, like persimmons, but not like persimmons. They will be less flavorful without a male and less smaller in size. They are in the same family as mulberries and figs, but the flavor is very different. The flavor is like a melon, actually. When you, it's the melon, very, very sweet melon, like sometimes even painfully sweet melon, I can taste. So like these fruits, you will not be able to eat a half kilo or a pound of these fruits. It's just incredibly sweet. And this fruit is also not really usual in terms of its pH. So this is a relatively high pH, which is still on the acidic side, but I think it's around 6.5, which is higher than most of other fruits. Most of the other fruits on them. On more acidic sides than this one. And some new cultivars, not new cultivars, but old cultivars also available, which can be yellow in size. I don't have yellow, but people told that they might have yellow. Actually, the cultivar I grow is a very particular cultivar because not everyone likes this fruit because they say it's really tasteless and not really flavorful, but this particular cultivar I grow originally came from nursery, which was in Oregon, and that's why I keep this cultivar under the name of Oregon Exotics. Actually, that nursery, which was operating in the 90s, distributed a number of different cultivars, but looks like this was the best one. And fortunately, it survived at least a few yards. And when I got this one, I started propagating it, and another friend also is propagating this one. So hopefully we'll keep this alive and distribute it further, and that will be here with us for future generations. So here I pressed some juice out of these fruits. You see, it's a very intense dark red, and next to it is a Kai apple. I'm probably going to talk about Kai apples the next one. Yeah, the tree is also very productive. You can see how many fruits I have here. It's a productive and precocious. So it fruits pretty early for me. Yeah. So Kai apple, on the other hand, is a very, I see, this is a juice from Kai apple. And this is a fruit from Kai apple. So if you never grew Kai apples, you may want to try them if you don't afraid of spines, because these particular trees are incredibly spiny and they have these really killer spines. If you can see spines here, you can see spines here. So basically they're about 2 inches long and they're very strong. This is something you really do not want to step on because they go through the sneakers really easily. It's not easy to collect these fruits, but you usually don't pick them from the tree. You usually want this fruit to fall and collect from the ground. And that's why this particular tree is one of my selected seedlings. I pruned it in that way. So now we can easily put some low containers under it, shallow containers here, and the fruits can drop right into those containers. But it's very productive. So this is selection, which I call sweet female number 4, because I started growing them, I don't know, maybe 6 years ago. And right now I have these 3 females which fruited, but one is the most sweet and most productive. And this is this number 4. So number 1 is more dense and not really productive. Number 2 is a typical sour fruit. And number 4 is a pretty sweet fruit. But keep in mind that this fruit is on the sour side, as opposite to Chem. But this particular selection is incredibly sweet, but it still has the acid in it. So, and the juice is incredibly yellow and stinky yellow. Okay. So the next fruit is Chirimoya. So Chirimoya is not really a fruit which is you can be easily grown in Davis. Like even in Davis, I would not put it anywhere open. Like I would not put it in my front yard, which is north facing front yard. Chirimoya still needs to be somehow protected in Davis and protected from both heat and cold. Chirimoya leaves can be easily burned by our sun. When we are above 100 degrees, they will kind of completely burnt and dry, and the tree becomes ugly, basically. And in winter, the young trees can be killed by frost. But what I did with this particular trees, I have two trees growing in my backyard. These are Fortuna, and I have another tree, which is Albampom. So they're very close to the wall, and that is eastern wall. So they are very well protected, but right now I even don't need to do any special protection. So the trees are pretty large, and what was surprising for me this year, I didn't have time to pollinate, and they actually making fruit, both trees making fruit. But one thing why I selected to talk about Fortuna. First of all, this particular cultivar is very early. And I think it is important. It means it also blooms early and it fruits in October, November. It's important for us here to have early blooming cultivars because you want to you want to get flowers fertilized before we have really really strong heat waves. Basically, if we are in above 100 degrees and it's very dry and very windy, if tree is blooming, there is a very low chance that these flowers will make into fruit. It's the same with dragon fruits. So you need a milder temperature for flower making into a fruit because Chirimoya is a high highlands of America. So it's really from cloud forests. So they're not something which is well adapted to our climate. So that's why I think the importance to having early blooming cultivars it should be stressed. So Fortuna does it, but somehow Fortuna was one of those cultivars which was very early registered by California rare fruit growers, but never got into distribution and to large scale distributions. Lots of other Chirimoyas you can see in box stores, they all coming from California rare fruit growers selections, but this one somehow got ignored and didn't get into distribution. But again, the wood can be obtained from me and few other people. I actually hold this particular tree from Santa Monica, so it exists in few backyards, but not in my name, and needs to be better distributed. And I already mentioned that I did some a little bit of selection, like 200 seedlings in Vacaville, and now I have a tree in Vacaville, seedling tree in Vacaville, which is making first two fruits now. So there is an probably an opportunity even growing Chirimoyas in Central Asia, in the farmlands of Central Valley here. Yeah. Okay, and next fruit. For fall is this senjet, or in Russia we called, not in, actually in Russia, and it's not really known in Russia, for in Central Asia, Uzbekistan, it was called jida, and that's the second word in the title here. The relatives of this tree known here in California and here in the US as Russian olive. I'm not sure it's the same species as Eleagnus angustifolia. It's probably Orientalis, or it's a cultivated form of angustifolia because the fruits are much larger, the fruits are much sweeter, and fruits are pretty tasty. And occasionally you can find them in fall and winter in Asian markets. And or online, you can also buy these fruits. I actually bought some online too, but now I'm producing these fruits. A friend gave me cuttings of Turkish cultivar. Now I also grow an Iranian version of this species. The fruits are very unusual because it's not soft fruit, it's not juicy fruit, it's basically a compacted powder fruit. You shell this berry, and inside is like, what do you call it, sugar candy? No. Basically, it's like dry sugar, which you put into your mouth and it dissolves. But it's not just sugar, it has lots of flavors in it. and they're all very nice. So as kids, we used to eat them from the trees in Central Asia because it was a very typical street tree where I grew up. And I'm thinking that it's actually would be a nice, nice addition to Californian landscapes too. I don't believe this tree can be invasive as Russian olive. Russian olives might be invasive in the situations where you have a summer rainfall. We don't have rainfall. And I heard from others that even who grows here, actual Russian olives, they didn't find them invasive at all. So you really need to provide irrigation for this tree in order for them to thrive here. Otherwise, they will not. One note here that the fruit flavor is very similar actually to the Lucuma meal, which I recently bought. And I found that Lucuma meal is actually very similar in flavor to Sinjet. But of course, Lucuma has its own specific flavors and Sinjet has its own specific flavors. But there is a certain level of similarity in the taste and the flavors between these two fruits, even they're coming from a completely different continents and systematically they don't have any relations to. Okay, I'm moving into winter unless we have questions.
There was a question or two, if you'd like to take those.
Yeah, sure, let's go, let's do it.
All right, so first there was a comment about the persimmon. Mm-hmm. Constantine said, from a limited sample, I see hybrids do much better in summer heat than Americans. So
that yeah, was just- I'm just starting. So I'm just got a number of hybrids and I'm going to evaluate them too, yeah. But I don't have yet any experience with hybrids.
Okay, great. From Goyton, we have, do you have any secrets for getting a good fruit set on cherimoyas?
No, weather. I think the weather is your best friend if you can control it. And you have to do manual pollination. And what I do, I also kind of spray my trees when they bloom with water. So just raising the humidity around the trees. But yeah, I'm basically ignoring most of my trees for most part. I have too many of them to care for any particular one. So when I'm watering my trees, I'm just trying to spray my cherimoyas with a fine spray just to kind of increase the humidity. That's it. Yeah, no. Yeah, hand pollination. You need to do it if you want.
Great.
Money.
Great. One more. Mm-hmm. From Allison, she asks, how large are the Sinjet trees?
They actually not large. I would say that they're medium trees. They also sometimes, especially them, because I have both experience with Sinjet seedlings and Sinjet cuttings, trees from cuttings. Trees from cuttings tend to be more of a bushy type. They like to grow as a bush. It just becomes a really large bush, tall bush. Maybe, I don't know, they can probably go to 10 feet, 12 feet easily. That's what I have now. Trees from seedlings seem to be actually more compact and more like a tree. So they make one trunk and they grow straight. But yeah, you should expect it. I'm not sure if it ever will reach like 20, 30 feet, but I would say it probably can easily reach like 15 feet, 20 feet maybe, yeah.
Great, thank you. That's all the questions.
Mm-hmm. And for winter, there are some late pomegranates. And if you want a pomegranate for winter, I would say you probably should think azadi, you probably should think gherkinets. There are tons of citrus you can grow in winter, guavas, some dragon fruits for me actually fruited end of February last winter. But what I found that white sapota actually can be a winter fruit. So first of all, a lot of mine fruited in December. And then I visited a friend in Morgan Hill in February, and his tree was fruiting abundantly in February. So in winter, when we have a relatively low amount of fruits which are not citrus, like what do I have? I have citrus, guava. Citrus is still one kind of fruit, I would say. I mean, one type. Guava and some late pomegranates, very few dragon fruits. So I think if we grow a lot of different white supporters, that will be a nice diversification in terms of what we have on the tables in winter. And that's why I'm going to talk about white supporter. I grow a lot of different cultivars now, and this winter, fall, winter, maybe into spring, I should have many more cultivars than listed here, because I already see how many trees are made fruit this year. They're finally getting into the fruiting size, because not all of them precocious, but the fruits which are listed on this slide, they actually precocious. So first of all, Vernon, you can get it in Home Depot, you can get it in Lowe's. So it's really easy to obtain cultivar. So go get Vernon if you never tried growing white supporter. Another precocious one is Neti fruit. Neti, not so easy to find, but occasionally we have it at the exchanges, and at some point I got a stick and grafted this too. So natives are precocious and also very nice fruit, probably even nicer than Vernon. Fish are fruited for me just recently. It's clearly precocious because it was a small graft which started fruiting right away. The interesting thing about fish, it didn't become mushy. So the fish can be overripe and stay as a whole fruit still. So that's an interesting thing about this cultivar. Also very low distribution for this one, definitely needs to be distributed better. And some others for which I didn't have pictures, but they're listed here, which fruited for me very fast. Santa Cruz, Subal, False Subal, and Gold Nugget. So they fruited all on very young trees. So that was my end of overview, and then just few concluding remarks I would like to make. So when you are making your fruit orchard, fruit garden, think about fruits also in the following categories, like a staple fruit and sprinkle fruit. So some fruits will produce a lot and you will be using them every day, and they will become your kind of a main fruits on the table. But there are also some fun fruits, rare fruits, not very unusual fruits like gingerberry and midgenberry. So those fruits are fun to grow, but you will have really just very few berries. So I would say when you're starting, only if you have space, dedicate space for like a gingerberry and midgenberry. Otherwise, they might take the same space as something else which will produce a lot. But it's fun to grow them. It's fun to grow them, but just the output will be very low from some of these really rare fruits. Okay, let me go to the next slide. Yeah, you already know about my blog, so much more recent information you will find there, and I try to post notes as I go, but sometimes I prepare the whole set of photos and I never have time actually to go and do it, but I'm doing my best. Okay, thank you so much for your time, and thanks so much for your attention. Yeah, and I will be happy to answer any questions if there are more.
Thank you so very much, Marta. We really appreciate it. So if anybody would like to ask a question, you may either put it in the chat and I will read it, or you can unmute yourself and go ahead and ask yourself. So Allison asks, how large is the tree or bush for a gin berry?
Gin berry. Gin berry is a citrus relative. I grow it in not really ideal conditions. So it's not very large, and it's fruited for me actually already for a couple of years. So what my tree, the space which my tree takes now is about 6 foot tall and maybe 2 to 3 feet wide. That's the space it takes now. But keep in mind that gin berry is very cold sensitive. I grow it very close to my porch, to my basically entrance to my yard, to my home. Yeah, so it's a cold sensitive, but it produces endive. So it takes down to probably easily to 30 degrees, but I don't know how it will behave in unprotected location. No, for me, it's not large tree, but maybe in India where it's coming from, maybe it will be much larger tree. So.
Great, thank you. Any other questions? Here we go. Kevin says, Marta, do you DNA test to confirm dragon fruit varieties?
No, I don't. Yeah, it's possible. It's all possible. And professionally, I'm pretty capable of doing that. But all those things, they cost money. And it's not just my time, but it's also you need to have reagents. You need to spend some time to figuring out what to do. So it's work. The publication was done, I don't know, Ramiro Lobo actually published at some point. And they have a nice tree, so it's possible to use their work as a base and do this SSR markers testing. But no, I do not. It's usually not worth it for our purposes.
Gotcha. Thank you. I have a question myself, actually. I have one of those large fruitless mulberries in my front yard, and I would love to graft some fruiting mulberries onto it. Since it's large, it has, you know, lots and lots of branches and everything. If I got a scion, where on the tree is the best place to graft it? Should I choose any old branch, or, you know, should I do close to the trunk, or is there another place that's best?
What I would do if I would have a large fruitless mulberry, I would top it like, I don't know, at least to, I don't know, maybe I would not leave more than 4 or 5 foot of it.
Okay.
And then wait for the strong shoots coming out and then graft those new like water sprouts, right? We call them. Water sprouts, these shoots with different cultivars.
Okay.
Because if you'll try to graft it on some branches, you know, there is on big trees, there might be a lot of competition with the neighboring branches and the tree might reject your graft. So,
okay.
But also keep in mind, if you have really old tree, your tree might not come back.
These trees always come back.
Okay. Yeah. So
people cut them all the way back to the big stubs, and then they always grow out again. So thank you. That's very helpful.
Actually, I have a comment on that. I have exactly the similar tree, male mulberry, and it had a lot of sprouts coming from like very low on the tree and from the bottom, and I grafted them to various cultivars. And all of them took.
Perfect.
And essentially the idea is they're low enough so I can get the fruit, because if I grafted higher on the tree, it would be just for birds.
So then can I ask you, is there too much shade because of the other branches around it? Does it matter?
But it has, you know, the entire tree has no other fruit, so it all goes into these branches there on the bottom. Even if they are shaded, you have so many other leaves which get sun on the tree.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Good. Thank you. Any other questions for Marta? All right. Well, that looks like it. Oh, here we go. Rachel asks, can you recommend somewhere to find shade fruit? Oh, and then I have another question after that.
What fruit?
The chia fruit?
Oh, chia fruit. Chia fruit. A nursery on East will be, I hope he will be making them. It's called Nut Trees. I think it's England. What is he? Ed England? What is his first name? I forgot now. Yeah, so I hope he will be making them with this particular cultivar. So chia fruits, you also can buy from Oregon Exotic. One Green World, but they have different cultivar. It's not the cultivar I grow. And yeah, basically, yeah, in winter, I'm happy to share the wood if we just need to do it somehow organized, because yeah, I'm not able, you know, to do hundreds of individual things, but I can transfer some wood to some chapters. Yeah, if you'll help me, especially to collect it and distribute it. Yeah, so it can be directly from me, or try to find online. Yeah, and I sent wood to Ed England. I said not Ed. Yeah, I forgot his name. Yeah.
I put the link to.
Put the link to Nut Trees. Yeah, and he has many other chia actually. I have only one. He has many, and he got now mine too.
Great, thanks. That link is in the chat now, and one or two more questions. Any tips on pruning white sapote tree? My tree is about 10 to 12 feet, but all the fruit is on the lower branches.
Yeah, just prune it. So white sapote is actually those fruits which really hard to manage for shape. They just do whatever they want. I pruned all the branches, and sometimes I just kind of tie them to the areas I want them to go. So just prune them. Some people just prune everything to 7 feet. And that's it. And they will grow back. That's all I can say about white sapotes. I prune them. I prune everything what goes too high for me to reach. Because yes, those fruits, you don't want them to fall. If they fall, they got mushy and it's basically gone.
Okay, great. Next, Stacy asks, what is the grafting compatibility for the different mulberries? Can they all be grafted to each other?
Yes. So I didn't see. So the only grafting compatibility is coming when you are trying to graft some nigra, Morus nigra. Not all Morus nigra will go onto alba. And nigra is those Persian ones which fruit between June and August. But some will go onto album. Like caster can easily be grow, and the most popular can be grafted onto alba. So generally, yes, most of mulberries can be grafted all together, especially like excellent rootstocks, for example. Well, all seedlings are excellent rootstocks, but like Four Seasons, World's Best, they're excellent rootstocks for everything else. But I grafted on Pakistan basically anything I needed to graft.
Okay, great. Stacy says that Planting Justice in Oakland sells chia trees for those closer to the bay. Mm-hmm. And then Kirk said he got his seedless chia from Edible Landscaping, mm-hmm, an online order.
Yep.
Great. And Olivia says, Marta, thank you for your excellent presentation. Your photos are beautiful. And I second that. They were great photos and a great presentation. Thank you so much for all of that. It was chock full of so much information. And I learned a ton, because I know very little about rare fruits still. And so I'm still a novice. And so it was very educational for me. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right. Yeah. You can feel free to stick around for the rest of our meeting if you'd like. Otherwise, I think we will be just going through our agenda